Dear students, welcome to first PUC biology online classes. I am Subramanya from Government Junior College, Nowunda. Let's start learning the chapter 6, Anatomy of Flowering Plants. This chapter introduces you to the internal structure as well as functional organizations of higher plants. Higher plants refers to the seed-bearing flowering plants, that is the angiosperms. In angiosperms, there are two groups of plants, that is monocotyledon and dicotyledon plants. Here we are going to study the internal details of both dicotyledon as well as monocotyledon plants. The study of internal structure of plant is called as plant anatomy. Here we have to know the definitions of plant anatomy. What is a plant anatomy? The study of internal structure of plants is called plant anatomy. N. Greve is called the father of plant anatomy. Another well-known name associated with the plant anatomy that is mentioned in the NCERT book, that is Catherine Issou. She had written the book Anatomy of Seed Plants, published in 1960. This is also referred as Webster's of Plant Biology. How we study the anatomy? We study the anatomy by taking the section of the plant. That section of the plant has to be examined with the help of microscope. That reveals the internal details of the plant. The internal details of the plant reveals that the plant body is formed of the cells as the basic unit. The cells are organized into tissues, and tissues in turn organized into organs. So the plant body is formed of various organs, that is root, stem, leaves, etc. Different organs of the plant shows differences in their internal structures. Within an angiosperm, dicot and monocot also seem to have different anatomical details. Internal structure also shows adaptation to diverse environments. Thus, the study of anatomy reveals the internal structure as well as several similarities and differences in the tissues and tissue systems. Hence, here we need to know what is a tissue. So, tissue is a group of cells having common origin and usually performing common function is called as tissue. In order to call a tissue, it must be a group of cells, the cells having the common origin, and it has to perform the common functions. That is what we referred as the tissues. The study of tissue is also referred as histology. The plant body is formed of different kinds of tissues. The tissues present in the plant is classified into two types, that is based on the capability of the cells to divide or not. What are the two types of plant tissues? That is meristematic tissue and the permanent tissues. Here we need to understand what is a meristematic tissues and what is a permanent tissues. On what basis this classification is done? This classification is done on the basis of capability of the cells to divide or not. Say, what is a meristematic tissues? It's a group of cells. That cells are immature and that cells have the capacity to divide. That constitute tissues, that is what we called as the meristematic tissues. What is a permanent tissue? Is a group of mature cells where the cells generally do not have capacity to divide. That is what we called as the permanent tissues. In other words, meristematic tissue is formed of immature, continuously dividing cells. Means the cells are undifferentiated. The permanent tissue is formed of mature cells
where the cells generally do not have capacity to divide. The permanent cells are also called as differentiated cells. How this differentiated cells is produced? Say the mesenchymatic cells is present, that mesenchymatic cells elongate and attain the definite size and shape to perform specific functions, during which it loses the capacity of cell division. That forms the mature cells or the permanent cells. The process by which the mesenchymatic cell converted into permanent cells, that is what we called as the differentiation. That means mesenchymatic cells through differentiation produces the permanent cells, that permanent cells produces the permanent tissue. Mesenchymatic tissue is formed of mesenchymatic cells. That mesenchymatic cells has certain characteristic features. What are the features of mesenchymatic cells? The cells are immature, continuously dividing, and has a dense cytoplasm and a prominent nucleus. That cell what we called as mesenchymatic cells. Mesenchymatic cells through differentiation produces the permanent tissues. Let's study the mesenchymatic tissues. In plants, the growth is restricted to certain specialized regions of active cell division, that is what we called as the meristems. In other words, what is a meristem? Are the tissues where active cell division and growth occurs. That is what we called as the mesenchymatic tissues or the meristems. Meristem that is present in the plant is classified into different types. Based on the formation or origin, there are two types of meristems, that is primary meristem and secondary meristems. What is a primary meristem? A meristem which appears early in the life of plant and forms the primary plant body, that is what we called as the primary meristems. What is a secondary meristem? A meristem appear later in the life of the plant and form the secondary plant body, that is called the secondary meristems. The primary meristem is responsible for the primary growth of plant, that is what we call increase in the length of plant. Increase in the length of plant is called primary growth. Secondary meristem is responsible for secondary growth, that is increase in the thickness of plant is called the secondary growth. This primary meristems classified on the basis of their location into two types, that is apical meristem and intercalary meristems. The primary meristem is classified into two types on the basis of location, that is apical meristem and intercalary meristem. On the basis of location, the secondary meristem is called as the lateral meristem. That means on the basis of location, the mesenchymatic tissues is classified into apical meristem, intercalary meristem and lateral meristems. What is an apical meristem? A meristem which is present at the apices of the root and the shoot, that is called apical meristem. Intercalary meristem, the meristem which is present between the mature cells or the permanent tissues is called as intercalary meristem. What is a lateral meristem? A meristem present in the mature regions of the plant, that is root and shoot, is called lateral meristem. During the formation of the primary plant body, this apical meristem produces three functional zones, that is what we call as the dermal tissues, ground tissues and vascular tissues. So this classification of meristem, that is based on the functions. means here apical meristems during the formation of the primary plant body produces three meristematic zones. What are those? That is dermal tissues, ground tissues and vascular tissues. So this classification, what we call as the classification of meristem, that is based on the functions. Let's study the classification of meristems on the basis of positions in the plant body. On the basis of position in the plant body, the meristem is classified into three types, that is apical meristem, intercalary meristem and lateral meristems or the secondary meristem. Apical meristem, as I already mentioned, it is present in the apices of the shoot and the root, that is called apical meristem. Intercalary meristem, that is present between the mature tissues, that is what we called as intercalary meristem. Lateral meristem, present in the mature regions of the plant, that is in the root as well as shoot, that is called lateral meristem or secondary meristems. Apical meristems. What is an apical meristem? Meristem which occurs at the tips of root and shoot and produces the primary tissues are called apical meristems. So there are two types. One is present at the tip of the root, that is what we call root apical meristem. Another one at the tip of the shoot, that is what we referred as shoot apical meristem. The root apical meristem, where it is present, it occupies the tip of the root. It is present in subterminal positions, that is, it is present behind the root cap. The root cap is also referred as an calyptra. It is an hemispherical. At the center of this, it is having the cells which shows very low mitotic activity, that is what we called as the quiescent zone. That represent the reserve meristems. During the formation of the primary plant body, this root tip produces four types of initials, that is the histogens. One is called as the initials for root cap, that is called calyptrogen. Another one, it produces the initials for the epidermis, that produces the protoderm, and initials for cortex, and also it produces the initials for central cylinder. Here the initials for central cylinder, that is what we called as the procambium. Initials for central cylinder is called procambium. And initials for cortex, that forms the ground meristems. So means three types of meristems and one root cap initials or calyptrogen is produced during the formation of the primary plant body, that is in the root tip. Let's study the shoot apical meristem. Shoot apical meristem. Shoot apical meristem occupies the distant most region of the stem axis. During the elongation and the formation of the leaves, some cells left behind by the apical meristem, that is present in the axils of the leaf, that is what we called as the axillary bud. What is an axillary bud? Some cells left behind from shoot apical meristem constitute the axillary bud. This axillary bud helps in the formation of branch or a flower. During the formation of primary plant body, the shoot apical meristem produces three meristematic zones, that is dermatogen, which produces the epidermis, ground meristem, which produces the ground tissues, and vascular tissues. That vascular tissue producing meristem, that is called as procambium, means three functional zones, that is vascular tissues, dermatogen, and ground tissues is present, that is in the shoot apical meristems. This shoot apical meristem is responsible for increasing the length of the shoot, that is what we called as the primary growth. Intercalary meristem. What is an intercalary meristem? The meristem which occurs between the mature tissues is called as intercalary meristems. They are usually found in monocots. In case of grasses, they regenerate the parts which is removed by the grazing herbivores. So where this intercalary meristem is present? Intercalary meristem is present at the nodal regions. So this intercalary meristem helps for elongation of the internodes. We have studied the apical meristem and intercalary meristem. This apical meristem and intercalary meristem is a primary meristem because they appear early in the life of the plant and contribute to the formation of primary plant body. Means it produces primary plant tissues, that primary plant tissues responsible for the formation of the primary plant body. We consider the function. What is the function of apical and intercalary meristem? Responsible for increasing the length of plant. During the formation of primary plant body, the shoot apex produces three functional zones, that is dermal tissues, ground tissues, and vascular tissues. Whereas the root apical meristem produces four functional zones, that is initials for root cap, that is calyptrogen, and initials for the cortex, that produces the ground meristem, and initials for central cylinder, that produces the vascular tissues, and another one, that is outermost, which produces the protoderm. So hence four functional zone or meristematic zone is observed where in case of the root tip. Another type of meristem, that is what we call lateral meristems. The meristem that occurs in the mature regions of the root and shoot is called as the lateral meristem. This lateral meristem is cylindrical meristems. Lateral meristem is also called as cylindrical meristems. So this lateral meristem responsible for producing the secondary tissues. That secondary tissues is responsible for increasing the thickness of the plant or girth of the plant, that is what we call secondary growth. Examples for lateral meristem, say the vascular cambium and cork cambium is example for the secondary meristem or the lateral meristem. Here this vascular cambium is formed of fascicular and interfascicular cambium. If you consider the origin, fascicular cambium is primary in origin, interfascicular cambium is secondary in origin. If you consider vascular cambium, this is partly primary and partly secondary in origin. But by function and structure, it is secondary meristem. So that's about the meristematic tissues. What is a permanent tissues? This is a group of cells which have lost the capacity of cell division either temporary or permanently to perform specific functions. That is what we called as permanent tissues. So here we are saying the cells produced by the primary and secondary meristems become structurally and functionally specialized. and loses the ability to divide. Such cells are termed as permanent cells and constitute the permanent tissues. Let me explain how this secondary meristem is produced. You know, the meristematic cells undergoes elongation and attains the definite size and shape to perform specific functions. During that, it loses the capacity of cell division, either temporary or permanently, that produces the permanent cells. The process by which meristematic cell is converted into permanent cell, that is what we called as differentiation. This permanent cells regain the capacity of cell division and becomes meristematic and produces the secondary meristem. The permanent cells regain the capacity of cell division and becomes meristematic. That process is called dedifferentiation. What is dedifferentiation? Permanent cells regain the capacity of cell division and becomes meristematic. That process is called dedifferentiation. Hence, what is a secondary meristem? Secondary meristem is the product of, dedifferentiated product of permanent cells. Dedifferentiated product of permanent cells is called the secondary meristems. Types of permanent tissues. What is a permanent tissues? Definitions. Group of differentiated cells which have lost the capacity to divide either temporary or permanently to perform specific function is called as the permanent tissues. So this permanent tissues is classified into two types, say the simple permanent tissue and complex permanent tissue. What is a simple permanent tissue? A tissue made up of only one type of cells is called as simple permanent tissue. What is a complex permanent tissue? A tissue made up of more than one type of cells is called as complex permanent tissue. Simple permanent tissue is made up of only one type of cells, hence it is also known as homogeneous tissues, whereas complex permanent tissue is made up of more than one type of cells, hence it is also called as heterogeneous tissues. Simple permanent tissue is made up of only one type of cells, means it is having homogeneous cells, whereas complex permanent tissue is formed of more than one type of cells, that is, it is heterogeneous. So that is the basic difference between simple permanent tissue and complex permanent tissue. What is a simple permanent tissue? A tissue is made up of only one type of cells. Complex permanent tissue is a tissue made up of more than one type of cells. Simple permanent tissue is classified into three types, that is parenchyma, colenchyma, sclerenchyma. Parenchyma is called as simple living permanent tissue. Colenchyma is called as living mechanical tissue. Whereas the sclerenchyma is called as dead mechanical tissues. This sclerenchyma has two types of cells, that is fiber and sclerites, that is based on the structure origin. The sclerenchyma tissue is classified into two types, fibers and the sclerites. The complex permanent tissue, it is divided into two types, that is xylem and phloem. Xylem and phloem are complex permanent tissues. The xylem is formed of the components or xylem elements, that is tracheids, vessels, xylem fibers, xylem parenchyma. Whereas phloem is also formed of the phloem components, that is sieve tube or sieve cells. Sieve tube in angiosperm, sieve cells in gymnosperms. Companion cells are albuminous cells, Companion cells in angiosperm, albuminous cells were in case of the gymnosperms. Phloem parenchyma and phloem fibers. These are the components of phloem. Say, types of permanent tissue. This permanent tissue is classified into two types, simple permanent tissue and complex permanent tissue. Simple permanent tissue, parenchyma, collenchyma, sclerenchyma. Complex permanent tissue, xylem and phloem. Let's study the simple permanent tissue. Simple permanent tissue, it is a tissue having cells similar in structure and functions are called simple permanent tissues. What is a simple permanent tissue? Tissue having only one type of cells and all the cells perform the similar functions that constitute simple permanent tissue. This simple permanent tissue is of three types, that is the parenchyma, simple living permanent tissue, collenchyma, living mechanical tissue, sclerenchyma, that is called dead mechanical tissue. Sclerenchyma has two types of cells, fiber and sclerites. Let's study the parenchyma. It's a simple living permanent tissue. Parenchyma is called as universal, fundamental and simple living permanent tissue. Why it is called universal? It is present in almost all parts of the plant. It is fundamental. From this parenchyma cells, other types of tissues also originate. Means the parenchyma cell has the de-differentiation capacity. Through de-differentiation, it produces other types of tissues. And it is also called as ground tissues because it is present in the cortex, pith, and the medullary rays, etc. Size of the parenchyma, size is isodiametric, shape spherical, oval or elongate in shape. If they are elongated, then what you called as prosenchyma. Elongated parenchyma is called as prosenchyma. Cell wall is thin and made up of cellulose. They may be either closely packed or have small intercellular spaces. Usually parenchyma is identified by the presence of, see here, the intercellular spaces. What is the functions of the parenchyma? Parenchyma perform the function of photosynthesis. The parenchyma cells which contain the chloroplast, that is what we call chlorenchyma, that chlorenchyma perform the function of photosynthesis. Parenchyma perform the function of storage. It stores the water, food substances and also the mucilage. That is what we call storage parenchyma. And also helps for secretion of resin or latex or gum, etc. So means the parenchyma take up the function of photosynthesis, storage or secretions. So that's about the parenchyma. Collenchyma is called as living mechanical tissue. Where the collenchyma is present? Collenchyma is present in the aerial parts of the plant, in dicots. It is absent in the root. Root does not have the collenchyma. And also the collenchyma is absent in monocots. Where this collenchyma is present in the aerial parts of the plant, particularly it is present in the hypodermis. The layer present below the epidermis, that is what we called as hypodermis. Hypodermis of the dicotyledons plant, we can identify the collenchyma cells. So this is the epidermis. Below the epidermis, you can see the collenchyma. This is the zone that is referred as hypodermis. The cells are thickened. Thickening is seen at the corner of the cells. This thickening is due to the deposition of substance that is called cellulose, hemicellulose and pectin. The secondary wall material, that is the pectin. The cells may be oval, spherical or polygonal. Usually the intercellular spaces are absent, that is in the colenchyma. What are the functions of colenchyma? They provide mechanical support to the growing parts of the plant, such as the young stem and petiole of leaf. The cells that contain the chloroplast also assimilate the food. Some of the colenchyma cells contain the chloroplast. If they contain the chloroplast, they help in assimilation of the food materials. So, what are the points you have to remember in colenchyma? The colenchyma are present only in the aerial parts of dicot plants, that is in the hypodermis. It is absent in the monocot. The cells are thickened. Thickening is seen at the corner of the cells. This thickening is due to the deposition of substance that is called cellulose, hemicellulose and pectin. The secondary wall material, that is the pectin. The cells may be oval, spherical or polygonal. Usually the intercellular spaces are absent, that is in the colenchyma. What are the functions of colenchyma? They provide mechanical support to the growing parts of the plant, such as the young stem and petiole of leaf. The cells that contain the chloroplast also assimilate the food. Some of the colenchyma cells contain the chloroplast. If they contain the chloroplast, they help in assimilation of the food materials. So, what are the points you have to remember in colenchyma? The colenchyma are present only in the aerial parts of dicot plants, that is in the hypodermis. It is absent in the monocot. And colenchyma is also absent in the root anatomy. This colenchyma cells also absent in the plant which has undergone secondary growth. And the cell wall thickening is due to the deposition of material, that is the pectin. And intercellular spaces are usually absent, that is in the colenchyma. Sclerenchyma. Sclerenchyma is a dead mechanical tissue. The cells are long, narrow, thick-walled and lignified cells, having few or numerous pits. They are usually dead and without protoplast. Say, the secondary wall material that is deposited in this is the lignin. The lignin is deposited on the inner side of the primary cell wall. As the lignin is deposited, it cuts off the water and oxygen supply to the protoplast, so that protoplast dies out. So that in the place of protoplast, lumen is created. Hence, sclerenchyma is a dead cell. This sclerenchyma is classified into different types, means mainly two types, on the basis of structure, origin and development. We can classify into two types, that is fibers and sclerites. Two types of sclerenchyma cells. What are fibers? They are thick-walled, elongated and pointed cells, generally occurring in groups in various parts of the plant. It is what we called as the fibers. What are sclerites? Sclerites are the spherical, oval or cylindrical, highly thickened dead cells, having very narrow lumen. That is what we called as the sclerites. Sclerite shape may vary. It may be the spherical, oval, cylindrical, having the thick wall and narrow lumen. That's what we call the sclerites. Where we find this sclerite? These are commonly found in the fruit walls of nuts, pulp of fruits like guava, pear, sapota and also in the seeds of leguminous and leaves of tea. Say it is present in the pulp of fruits like guava and pear. In that, it is called as the brachiosclerites, whereas those which is present in the seed cores of leguminous plant, there are two types of sclerites is present: rod-like, that is macrosclerites, and another one bone-shaped, that is what we called as osteosclerites. In the leaves of tea, the sclerites has a star shape. Star-shaped sclerites is present where in the case of tea leaves. What is the function of sclerenchyma? Sclerenchyma provides mechanical support to the plant organs, means it provides the rigidity and strength to the plant organs in which it is present. So that's about simple permanent tissues. Let's study complex permanent tissues. What is a complex permanent tissue? It is a tissue formed of more than one type of cells, and they work together as unit, that is called complex permanent tissues. This complex permanent tissue is classified into two types, that is the xylem and the phloem. Xylem helps in conduction of water and minerals, whereas the phloem helps for conduction of food materials. As the xylem and phloem helps in conduction of food materials as well as the water and minerals, they are called as conducting tissues. Means complex permanent tissue is generally called as conducting tissues or the vascular tissues. Consider the xylem. Xylem is also known as wood. Xylos means wood. What is a xylem? Xylem is a complex permanent tissue, helps for conduction of water and minerals from root to the stem and leaves. That is what we call as the xylem. Another important functions performed by the xylem, it provides a mechanical strength. There are two important functions we can ascribe to xylem. One is the conduction of water and minerals. Another one, it provides the mechanical strength to the plant body. The xylem is composed of four kinds of elements, that is tracheids, vessels, xylem fibers and xylem parenchyma. These tracheids, vessels and xylem fibers are the dead components of the xylem, whereas xylem parenchyma is the living component of xylem. Mention the living component of xylem, that is the xylem parenchyma. Remaining all tracheids, vessels and xylem fibers are the dead components. Let's study the tracheids. What are tracheids? These are elongated tube-like dead cells. What are tracheids? Tracheids are the elongated tube-like dead cells. The wall is lignified and has tapering ends. The protoplasm is absent, hence it is a dead. Tracheid is also a dead cells. So the inner layers of the cell walls have thickening in various forms of thickening we can see in the inner wall of tracheids, that is annular, spiral or reticulated or pitted manner. The lignin is deposited on the inner walls. Tracheids is the predominant water conducting elements, where in case of pteridophytes and gymnosperms, it is also present in the angiosperms. In angiosperms, the tracheids is called as tracheid fibers. Say, what are tracheids? tracheids are elongated tube-like dead cells. You have to remember, tracheids are cells. What cells? They are elongated dead cells having tapering ends. Let's go to the vessels. What is a vessel? It is a long cylindrical tube-like structure. While describing the tracheids, we are saying that long cylindrical tube-like cells. Here it is a cylindrical tube-like structures. That is called as the vessels. And it is made up of many cells. That cell is called as the vessel members. The wall is lignified. Each vessel member, the wall is lignified. And it has a large central cavity and the protoplasm is absent. Hence, vessel is also a dead cell. So what is a vessel? Vessel is not a cell, it is a tube-like structure. Say, what is a vessel? It is a long cylindrical tube-like structure made up of many cells. The individual cells is called as vessel members. The vessel members are interconnected through a perforation in their common walls. Means one vessel member, this is the one vessel member is connected to another vessel member through the common walls. This common walls has an perforations. Vessels are the characteristic features of an angiosperms. Means it is the predominant water conducting elements in case of the angiosperms. Gymnosperms usually lack the vessels. There are exceptions to this is that if you consider the neatum and ephedra, where the vessels is also present. So ephedra and the neatum belongs to gymnosperms. Usually gymnosperms lack the vessels. So that's about the vessels. Another component of the xylem, that is called xylem fibers, are also referred as wood fibers. The cells are highly lignified and having obliterated central lumen. So lumen is indistinct. Lumen is obliterated. They are septate or aseptate. Septa may be present or it may be absent. They are more abundant in secondary xylem. Say, xylem fibers are present mainly in the secondary xylem. It is absent in the gymnosperms. Hence the gymnosperm, the wood is referred as soft wood. Another component of the xylem, that is the living component of xylem, that is the xylem parenchyma. The cells are thin-walled with cellulosic cell walls. Means these are nothing but the parenchyma cells associated with the xylems. That is called xylem parenchyma. What is the function performed by the xylem parenchyma? They help to store the food materials like the starch or the fat and also the other substances like the tannins. The xylem parenchyma also helps in radial conduction of water. Say, the ray parenchymatous cells that is present in the fruit helps in the radial conductions of water. On the basis of origin, the xylem is of two types, that is primary xylem and secondary xylem. The primary xylem develops from the procambium in the early life of the plant, whereas the secondary xylem develops from the vascular cambium. So here, the primary xylem is divided into two types on the basis of its development. Say the primary xylem is divided into two types on the basis of development. That is protoxylem and metaxylem. So what is a protoxylem? The first formed primary xylem, that is called as the protoxylem. What is metaxylem? The later formed primary xylem that is called as the metaxylem. So this is the metaxylem, larger vessels, and this is the protoxylem having the smaller vessels. Protoxylem has the smaller lumen, whereas the metaxylem has the larger lumen. Say, what is a protoxylem? The first form, primary xylem, is called protoxylem. In protoxylem, the lignification occurs before the elongation of the cells, whereas in metaxylem, the lignification occurs after the elongation of cells. And in protoxylem, the wall thickening is in the form of annular or spiral forms, whereas in case of metaxylem, the wall thickening is mainly in reticulate or pitted forms. In pitted forms, there are two types: simple pits and bordered pits. So this is the classification of xylem, that is the primary xylem, on the basis of development. On the basis of position of protoxylem to the central axis of the plant organs, the xylem is classified into two types, that is endarch xylem and exarch xylem. What is an endarch xylem? Protoxylem lies toward the center, that is in the near the pith, and metaxylem lies toward the periphery, that is called as the type of arrangement that is called as the endarch arrangement. The xylem is said to be endarch, that is in case of stem. In stem, the xylem is endarch. See, this is the metaxylem vessels, this is the protoxylem vessels. The metaxylem toward the periphery, protoxylem toward the center. That arrangement is called as endarch arrangement. In roots, the protoxylem toward the periphery and metaxylem toward the center. That arrangement is called as exarch. So the primary xylem may be endarch or it may be exarch. So the endarch and exarch term is used only for primary xylem. There is no differentiation in case of secondary xylem. Endarch and exarch term we are not used for the secondary xylem. It is applied only for the primary xylem. In primary xylem, protoxylem toward the center, metaxylem toward the periphery, then it is called endarch. Example, in stems, both dicot stem and monocot stem. And exarch, metaxylem toward the center, protoxylem toward the periphery. Example in case of root. So this is about the complex permanent tissue, that is the xylem.